everybody. Welcome to the 14th and final broadcast of Physics 100, Patterns in Nature, for spring of 2011. This is our last broadcast. I'll be telling you in a minute what's going on after the last broadcast, because you all know there's something. The topic for today, I call the atom, what's inside counts. Before we get to the atom and what's inside, we have our usual administrative details. This is it. We're at lecture 14 of 14. Once you've seen this, you've seen the whole set for the course. And I remind you that all of the episodes are archived on YouTube, on the university's YouTube channel. You can go watch them anytime you like. You can sit and have a physics marathon on Saturday. Great fun that would be. I actually also have a little reminder for you that a couple of weeks ago, I tossed out this idea that you could do an extra credit project of a photo project. Find a neat optical effect, take a picture of it, send me either the picture or a link to the picture, and explain it. Before I show you some of the student work here, I do want to remind you it's a photo that you take, not a photo that you find. It's easy to find photos around. That's a nice thing generally to do. But for this project, we're looking at photos that you took. I have an example of some student work. If we can bring up that graphic. Here we got it. Jeff has sent us this picture. Looks like a beautiful little rainbow. And it's a little hard to tell the way the picture is rendered behind me, but it's on a cloth, basically. And it's in his apartment. He found that, in fact, this rainbow seems like it's not because of just the usual prism effect of glass or plastic being in a little triangle, but rather from interference at an edge. The curve through it is because the cloth that it's projected on is not flat. Makes it look more beautiful and artistic. When you see this photo close up, as I have, honestly, it's one of those that you look at it and you say, wow, that's a really pretty picture. And in fact, to me, understanding it, knowing why that could be that way, makes it even more beautiful. And hopefully that's one of the things you get out of this course. Today I'm going to spend a few minutes a couple different times trying to link things back to the very beginning, what it is I hope you get out of the course. Other administrative detail, probably the biggest question for most of you, is what about the final exam? I'm still working on it. Honestly, I have not gotten so much of it done. I've made a bunch of decisions, which I'll tell you about in a moment. I've not made up the problems yet. It will open, that is, be available on Blackboard on Sunday, May 15th. That's the very beginning of finals week, in the afternoon or evening. I haven't picked an exact time yet. It will be available until Wednesday, May 18th in the evening. If somebody has a problem with that, tell me before the finals. Send me an email. That should be enough time. The exact time I assign for it, in fact, finals are nominally scheduled for 2 hours. So nominally, try to finish it in 2 hours, but I will let you take longer if you need it. Time should not be a consideration on this, but you need to get it started well before the closing deadline. I've decided that I rather liked putting the test in two parts for the midterm. I will do that again. But one of the decisions that I've made is that for the final, more of the weight, that is, more of the points proportionally, will be in the section on multiple choice short problems or matching, fill in the blanks, those kind of problems. So a lot of the most of the points will be in that kind of problem, the short, multiple choice, matching, fill in the blanks, type of problem, and a smaller number of points in the longer questions that ask you to calculate. But there will be some of both, and they will be in different sections. And you don't have to take them at the same time. You can take one Sunday and take another on Tuesday. You can do them in either order, if you like. It's up to you. As I said, I've not yet written the problems. So feel free to ask me anything about what I'm thinking of for topics. I think I mentioned last time I would prepare a set of notes for myself about what I need to ask. And when I do, I'll post it on Blackboard. I'll put a link. I'll put an announcement to it. So watch for that announcement. I'll have it email people. That's enough for administration. I want to get right into material. I've got a fair amount of new stuff I want to hit today. And I do want to look back, as I've been doing, in the broader view, and then a quick review of few things from last time that are going to be critical for today's lesson. What we've talked about already started, as I keep saying, with a lot of generic wave stuff. Things about all sorts of waves, what makes a wave a wave, what makes it different from a particle. The first big example that we spent a lot of time on for waves was sound. And sound was given both in its own right and as an example of several wave properties. Talked about interference, talked about reflection of sound bouncing off of walls, and echoes. After sound, talked about electricity and magnetism and how it relates to waves in particular. Didn't spend a lot of time on that. It was four chapters in the text, summarized in an 8-page set of notes that our department makes. And it was really only about how that relates to waves, because after that, we were going to get to light. We took a little digression in March to talk about what was happening in the world and how that relates to our class. This is the second time I say it's a nice time to think about what you want to get out of this class, what you want to understand, not just what I want you to understand, but what you want to understand, and how that will apply to things like life and understanding the news. Then we did get onto light. Within light, we talked about how we see it, how it moves, what makes light, color, many things like that. More recently, we got from light and made connections to how light's produced to atoms, quantum mechanics, the physics of small stuff, small things. From that, we spent a while, most of the day, talking about the atom and our model for the atom called the Bohr model, and how that relates to the periodic table of the elements, and in some way explains very much of chemistry. Finally, last time, cleaning up a little bit of that, we also talked about nuclear isotopes and nuclear decay. That's where we were last time. Nuclear decay included this alpha, beta, gamma decay. I should mention there's more, but that's enough to keep us busy for a while in this course. The nucleus itself consists of protons and neutrons, things we called nucleons. The protons repel each other. They're both positive charged, two protons. They're the same charge, and likes repel. But the nucleus stays together. Something must be holding that together. You might think the neutrons must be the paste that holds protons together. But whatever it is, there's some kind of force that holds it all together. We called that the strong force, the nuclear strong force. A force that holds it together, though, can't explain things like beta decay, where something comes out of the nucleus that wasn't there before. because there are no electrons in the nucleus. And I told you that a beta ray was an electron. So there's some other force, which we won't talk any more about, but I want to admit to. It's called the weak force. The nuclear weak force is the force that explains beta decay. And that's really enough for us right now, because we're not doing a full science majors physics course. But it's good to know there's an extra force in nature called the weak force. And you can guess why we call it that. It's not as strong as the strong force. In our talk about the nucleus, characterizing it by protons and neutrons and how many protons and neutrons there are, we needed to introduce some new vocabulary, and the word isotopes came up. Isotopes are elements that have the same atomic number, Z, but different number of neutrons, which is A minus Z, so different atomic mass number. Isotopes, big vocabulary word. The way we write isotopes formally is with a superscript for the atomic mass number and a subscript for the atomic number and the chemical symbol. That's one of the notations we use. But I used that last time, and you'll see that again today. We did talk very briefly at the end. I introduced the idea that there were a couple more processes that were important. One of them is called nuclear fission. That's my first big topic for today. Nuclear fission is a process, basically, instead of a nucleus decaying, spitting out some little piece, it's a nucleus breaking apart into similar size chunks. This happens because the strong force, the thing that holds the nucleus together, has a limited range. So if I look at this nucleus next to me, something's holding it together. It's the strong force. The strong force acts between protons and neutrons and holds them together. But it only has a limited range. It doesn't act for very far. On the other hand, the electric repulsion of protons has an infinite range. It gets weaker and weaker as the protons get apart, but there's still some effect. That's different from the strong force. So even though the strong force is stronger, if I have two protons a little distance away, the repulsion overwhelms that. Neutrons help. They help keep it together because they participate in the strong force, just like protons do. This is the nuclear physics way of looking at it. The more modern view that, again, I won't talk much more about, is something that I very briefly showed last time with this diagram of quarks and leptons and only a dozen different things. Brad has just sent in a question asking, out of which elementary particles is the neutron made? And this is a good question. It's an interesting question, because protons and neutrons are made out of the same types of elementary particles. Both of them are made out of what we call up and down quarks. The proton has two up quarks and one down quark, and the neutron has one up quark and two down quarks. They're both made out of the same thing. It's a lot like in chemistry, I can make different molecules out of the same elements. I can make water out of one oxygen, two hydrogen, or I can make hydrogen peroxide out of two oxygen, two hydrogen, bound together in a slightly different way. So, Brad, the answer is up and down quarks. And everything that you see in nature is made out of protons, neutrons, and electrons. All of the matter that you see. So all of the matter you see is made of up and down quarks and electrons. The neutrons help hold this nucleus together by having strong force. in general, that would tell us when you get larger and larger nuclei, where the proton repulsion still matters side to side, but the strong force doesn't help, you need more neutrons per nucleus. That's the general trend. And again, in a fuller course, we'd talk at some length about that. Most nuclei are roughly spherical. In fact, like this picture behind me, once you get several nucleons together, you can think of these little balls fitting nicely into a bigger ball. But when you start to think about elementary particles, like Rad is doing, and what they're all made out of, you realize that these things aren't little balls. They fit together differently somehow. One of the models that's sometimes useful to describe a nucleus is called the liquid drop model. Sometimes we actually think of the nucleus as though it were a drop of liquid, like a water droplet. And water drops tend to be spherical, that is, round, circles. That's the most stable shape in nature. It's the simplest shape in nature. Some large nuclei are not spherical. They're stretched out and long. In fact, if I can do something to give extra energy and make this non-spherical nucleus vibrate, it might get very stretched. It's easier to break something if it's not spherical. So I drew a little cartoon here. I've got a nucleus that's spherical and a nucleus that's not spherical. If I throw some subatomic particle at the spherical nucleus, in fact, I might make it jiggle with the extra energy, and I might produce this non-spherical nucleus, a different isotope. If that shakes enough that the proton charges on each end are repelling very strongly compared to the amount of strong force that can be experienced over this large distance for a nucleus, you might find that this actually breaks. And when it breaks, I can get two smaller nuclei. I might also get other things coming out, like a neutron or a few neutrons. In this picture, these little dots I've drawn are neutrons. The large black shapes are nuclei. The first two on my left are different isotopes of the same nucleus, but one of them is stretched out, elongated. This process by which the stretched out nucleus breaks into smaller parts of similar size is called nuclear fission. Nuclear fission, or just fission for short. That step right there. Nucleus breaks into pieces of similar size. We can have nuclear fission that occurs in nature, or we can do what's called induced nuclear fission. That means we can make it happen in a lab. In particular, one isotope that's very important to studying fission is uranium-235. U-235 undergoes fission if it's hit by a neutron, as in the picture I drew. In fact, this picture I drew is a lot like a picture in your textbook where they show U-235 fissioning, breaking in half. And I didn't tell you what the smaller parts are because there are many, many possibilities. In your textbook in the picture, they give one example. But there are many possibilities for what the smaller fragments can be. It depends on exactly how the material, the protons and neutrons in that nucleus, split up when it pulled apart. Notice that it breaks into smaller fragments, smaller pieces, smaller elements, plus neutrons. The interesting thing about this is that the mass that I started with isn't the same as the mass that I end with. The mass that I start with in this U235 fission is a little bit more than the mass that I end with. I say the initial mass is greater than the final mass. That is, the mass of one neutron and U235 is a little bit more than the mass of the fragments I get plus however many neutrons I get. When this happens, some energy is released. The mass that I start with, one neutron, one uranium-235 nucleus, is equal to the mass of whatever fragments I get, whatever neutrons I get, and some energy that I get divided by a number. The more nicely drawn picture, like the one in your textbook, but not exactly the same, is shown here. And let me draw on this a little bit. If I have a U235 nucleus that I start with, and I hit it with a neutron. In this picture, they've drawn the arrows to show them coming together. It's more like, the way I drew it, looks more like the neutron is thrown at it. It's the same idea. But the point is, in this example, it breaks into a nucleus called barium-141 and krypton-92. But if you try to account for all of the neutrons, 92 plus 141 is 233, not 236. So I started with 235 plus 1 nucleons, and I've only got 233 in the fission products. That's why I need these three extra neutrons. Notice, those three extra neutrons are now neutrons floating around. They can induce more fissions. There's lots of energy involved in this, but before I go on about the energy, which is going to be one of the big points, I want to get back because Brad has more questions. He asks about the neutron being made of just three quarks. How can it send out an electron, a proton, and an antineutrino during decay? And his question then is, can elementary particles change into other elementary particles? The short, simple answer to that question is yes. In the weak interaction, and I call it interaction here instead of force, because I'm thinking of it in a slightly different way. If I wanted to draw what happens in beta decay, or decay of a neutron, Brad has learned that a neutron decays into a proton, which has a positive charge, an electron, or beta particle, which has a negative charge, and something called an antineutrino. In fact, I put a subscript E because it's an anti-electron neutrino, and the bar means anti. So these are three things that come out when a neutron decays. If I wanted to look at some nuclear beta decays where there's a real nucleus involved. Carbon, let me think, lithium 7. And lithium has 3 protons. If I remember right, it doesn't matter if I don't remember right because it's only an example, I believe it can beta decay. And a beta is the same thing as an electron. It has a negative charge. I started with 3 positive charges, and I'm getting a negative charge, so I must have, in fact, 4 positive charges on this side, 4 protons. If I look on the periodic table for what's under 4, it's called beryllium. The beta, or electron, has almost no mass. I had 7 nucleons to start with. I need 7 nucleons on this side, and only the beryllium is there. There will again be an anti-electron neutrino. This is not an answer to the question at all. This is another example of the same thing. And this electron and this beta are the same thing. Brad's question is more about, this was the nuclear way of looking at it. What is the fundamental elementary interaction, as far as we think of it now, with quarks? So on the same sheet of paper, I want to draw a quark picture of the same thing. I said that a neutron was an up, a down, and a down. And I said that a proton was an up, an up, and a down. And I've got also my electron, and I'm going to put that in a different place here. And the antineutrino. Oops. The particle physics way of looking at this is that this up quark and one of the down quarks just hangs around going along for the ride. One of the down quarks hangs around going along for the ride. The other down quark, the one in the middle there, sorry about that, goes along and interacts with this particle called a W boson. And the W boson turns the down into an up. And then it splits into the E minus and the antineutrino. There's a lot more to the picture than that. And frankly, if I wanted to explain it better, I could spend all day talking about that. Honestly, this is my field, so I would be comfortable with that. But I do need to get on to the other things we were going to talk about today. In fact, Brad, if you want later, I can send you some links to some real information to follow up just so you can learn more about that. I can put some documents I've written for a different course onto our Blackboard page so that you can access them. So if you want more information on that, you can email me and I'll send you a couple documents and some pointers to Wikipedia pages that do a pretty good job of that. Right now, I was back on the missing mass in fission. Again, fission, we were looking at a big nucleus breaking into fragments, smaller nuclei, and giving us some neutrons. And I claimed that what happens is energy is released. In fact, it's a lot of energy. Not just some energy, a lot of energy. For example, if I looked at energy from hydropower, New York State has a lot of hydropower. The northern part of the state gets between 30% and 50% of its power from Niagara Falls. Hydropower, each drop of water gives us a few of some basic unit of energy. And this basic unit of energy that I'm going to use now is called the electron volt. So I'm going to take notes on these numbers, so I have them written down together. The drop of water one droplet, which seems like a small amount, is about 4 of these units called electron volts. If I had a molecule of TNT, one molecule, absurdly small amount, but TNT you've probably heard of. It's used in explosives. It's an active ingredient in dynamite. The amount of energy in a single molecule is about 30 electron volts. Notice, one molecule is tiny compared to a drop of water. A drop of water that you could see is billions of molecules. Water is getting this energy from gravity, falling down, literally. TNT is getting chemical energy that really, for us, is basically from atomic pieces moving around with charges on them. If I wanted other chemical energy that didn't sound so destructive, I might talk about gasoline. A molecule of gasoline, one of the molecules in that mixture called gasoline is octane, but a molecule of gasoline gives about the same amount of energy as a molecule of TNT, about 30 of these units. One nucleus of uranium-235 fissioning, just one of them, gives about 2 × 10⁸. That's 200 million EV. That's a lot. 50 million times as much energy for each nucleus that fissions than a whole droplet of water falling. Okay. That's a big difference. If we can use this, might be a good source of energy. Before we get to talking about it as a source, let me take a little detour, because I claimed that that energy came from somewhere. I should talk about where the energy came from. Large nuclei have more mass than small nuclei. You shouldn't be shocked by that. Big books have more mass than little books. In fact, not just shouldn't be shocked, you should say, well, duh. The real surprise, though, the thing that is not at all duh, is that large nuclei have more mass per nucleon than small nuclei do, or at least certain nuclei. Protons, heavier per nucleon. Protons and neutrons that are in a uranium nucleus, any isotope of uranium, protons and neutrons in uranium weigh more than protons and neutrons do in iron. There's more mass for the same thing. This was a bit of a mystery to scientists for a few decades in the early 20th century. It's due to something we call binding energy. Basically, atoms nuclei are held together by something that takes energy. In the early part of the 20th century, Einstein had related energy to mass in some way. He wrote a famous equation that people associate with his theory of relativity that says the energy equivalent of some mass is that mass value times this number C squared. E equals mc squared. You've probably heard people say it. In fact, I think people say it more or less to act like it's something smart without knowing what it is or what it means. I want to look at that formula because energy, I know what energy is. I can lift books up on top of a shelf, takes energy. I can explode TNT, I get energy. Mass, I know what that is. I eat more cheesecake, the next morning I have more mass. This number C is the speed of light. Now, this equation is actually one small part of a much bigger theory. But the big point here is that the energy that you get, if you can convert mass directly into energy, is huge. Because the speed of light, this number, is a really big number. In our units, it was 3 times 10 to the 8th meters per second. And we're squaring that. So if I can convert just a tiny bit of mass, I get a huge amount of energy. This is why fission gives us not just millions, but tens of millions of times more energy than dropping water. The most stable isotopes, the ones with the greatest binding, the least massive protons and neutrons, are isotopes of iron. Iron isotopes, very stable. In fact, I should have a graph that I can look at with binding energy on it. Yes. This graph behind me, which I can point out some features of, has on the x-axis number of nucleons in nucleus, and on the y-axis average binding energy per nucleon in some units. And I don't care that much about what the units are. I've got energy on the y-axis, number of nucleons on the x-axis. On the right side, two isotopes of uranium. In the middle, iron 54 is pointed out, one of the most stable nuclei. On the left side, I start with a couple of isotopes of hydrogen. Up here is regular helium, and here are two other isotopes of hydrogen and helium. If I have a lot of binding energy in the hydrogen, the difference in energy per nucleon between that and the uranium isotopes, that difference is what's available to me if I can make that uranium fission into iron. Now, it doesn't really fission all the way there. In fact, it stops, hits some stable isotopes somewhere in that range. So I can get a large amount of energy from fissioning uranium. Again, that the fact that there are stable isotopes is what matters. One nucleus fissioning will give me huge amounts of energy. Just as important, though, is that when uranium fissions, I get more neutrons. Because I needed a neutron to make that happen. And when one of them breaks apart, it gives me 3 neutrons. So you might think, well, then I can get 3 more of these things to happen. It depends, because this works with U-235. It does not work with U-238. So how this happens, how much I can make this happen, depends on the concentration, that is how much I have of U-235 compared to U-238. U-238 will not fission, U-235 will. If I have very, very little U-235 and I do get one fission, probably the neutrons from that hit U-238 or something else that's in the same piece of material. Then nothing happens. If there's a lot of U-235, then I have a good chance of hitting it when a neutron comes out. But what if I only have a very thin piece of material? And maybe this neutron, instead of hitting U-235 or U-238, can just get all the way out of the material. Whether I get more fission or not depends critically on something we call the mean free path. Mean free path is how far a neutron or whatever we're talking about will go before it probably bumps into something. You can think about it as when you're walking around in a crowd. If you walk around in a crowd and there aren't many people there, you can walk for several steps before you bump into someone. If there are a lot of people around, you'll probably bump into somebody very soon. If there are very few people around, you won't bump into somebody very soon. It's a little like that with the neutrons walking around. If they can leave the sample, if I have a small sample, a little thin thing, and the neutrons travel far before they hit something, they probably get out. They're not going to hit anything in this piece of uranium. If I have a very big piece of uranium, and the neutron starts here, if it goes that far, well, then it'll probably hit another uranium nucleus. If I have a small sample, most likely the neutrons escape. If I have a very big sample, most likely the neutrons, each one creates more fissions, if there's enough U-235. There's some break-even point that we call the critical mass. Critical mass is the point where the sample is just big enough that when a few neutrons are let out, probably one of them starts a new fission. If one of them starts a new fission, then its neutrons, probably one of them starts another fission. This is called critical mass because if I go above that, if I have a bigger piece, probably more than one of them starts another fission. And for each of those, probably more than one of their neutrons start another fission. And the reaction here gets bigger and bigger and bigger. If my sample's too small, the reaction just dies out. If it's too big, it gets bigger and I can't control it. The critical mass is the right size with the right concentration so that the reaction keeps going but doesn't build up too much. To get this right, you have to make sure that you have the right isotopic abundance. I called it concentration before. You need the right amount of U-235 versus U-238. Or, instead of U-235, I could use something else that fissions, like plutonium. So if I want to have a reaction of fission that continues, I can make uranium that has more than the natural amount of U-235, or I can make uranium with some plutonium in it. If I want to make plutonium, how do you make a new element? Well, I mentioned before about creating isotopes in the lab. In fact, plutonium is only created in laboratories or in reactors. It does not occur in nature in any measurable amount. If we have U-235 and we hit it with a neutron, we get fission. So U-235 plus N gives me fission. It breaks up into smaller fragments. But if I have this happening in a big sample of uranium, some of those neutrons hit U-238. What happens then? This is the important interaction for what we want to look at right now. U-238, if we hit it with a neutron, does not fission. In fact, it creates U-239. Not surprising. Because if I'm not going to have it break up, then the number of protons, 92, stays the same. And the number of neutrons increases by 1. U-239 beta decays. That is, it spits out an electron or beta particle, an antineutrino, which we ignore usually. But if this is negative, I started with 92 positive charges, I need 93 now. But I still have 239 nucleons. And I look in the periodic table for what's 93. It's called neptunium. And I'll write in my neutrino just to be careful. But that just flies away. This process happens with a half-life. Remember half-life? Of about 24 minutes. So, relatively quickly, if I have uranium-238 and it's hit by neutrons, if I wait a few hours, most of that will have converted into neptunium-239. The neptunium-239 also decays. It's also a beta decay. And since the beta is negative, and I started with 93 protons, positive charges, I need 94 to make the charges balance on both sides. The beta does not affect the number of nucleons, so I still have 239. And when I look up 94, that is plutonium. And again, I have an antineutrino that flies away and usually is ignored. This process, oops, need this to write again, has a half-life of about 2.3 days. Days, not hours, not years. So in a reactor that has some U-235 and some U-238, the U-235, when hit by neutrons, will fission. The U-238, at least some of it, may be converted to plutonium. And plutonium-239 is what we call fissionable. That is, when hit with a neutron, it will also fission, just like uranium-235. The details, exactly what the products are, exactly how many neutrons, are different. But the general point is the same. Plutonium-239 can be used for fission. Reactors that are optimized for this, ones that are engineered to make plutonium rather than make energy, mostly, are called breeder reactors. Breeder reactors are used to make isotopes, and in particular, plutonium. So we've covered a lot already. It's probably going to take you a 5-minute break to digest all of this. But when we come back, I'll talk about how we do use this and go on to the next big process. See you in 5 minutes.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Ladies and gentlemen, and particularly Senator Ted Lieu and your beautiful wife Betty and your family, welcome to the 55th Assembly District, now a part of, as you well know, the 28th Senate District, which you now represent. Ladies and gentlemen, it's always great to have such pomp and circumstance to remind all of us of the role of government and the important work that we do.
I'd like to ask the Honorable Ted Lieu to come on stage, and with the Chairman of the Board of Equalization, Jerome Horton, a former California State Assembly member, an Inglewood City Council member, and a, as you heard, a graduate of this fine institution, to administer the oath of office.
Aye. Your name.
Do solemnly swear
that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
Against all enemies. Foreign and domestic.
Foreign and domestic.
That I take this obligation freely. With Betty's permission.
Without any mental reservations.
Or purpose of evasion. And that I will well and faithfully discharge the duties. By the power vested in me, I hereby announce and present to all of you the Senator Ted Lieu.
Ishmael Lewis Summers. I am a transfer student from Humboldt State University to Dominguez Hills. I am a DMA major at Dominguez Hills, and why I chose the school was because of their digital media art program. And what I like about this school is that it is cool and it is very diverse.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
I just thought it'd be funny. I don't know how much you guys watch those little intermissions, but in that bit with the flash mob dance, one of those dancers on the stage is one of our physics majors. So go Ruben. Back to work now. We were talking about fission, and I told you that you can get fission by using uranium-235 or plutonium-239. There are lots of other things that we could have fission reactions with. Those two are common for what we really do. Other things are possible. That's what's practical. So I want to get to practical, using fission. How could we use it? Well, it's got 50 million times more energy than a drop of water falling for each one nucleus. So that's a huge amount of energy. Such a large source of energy could be used for something. Easy thing to use it for. You have a large source of energy. If you don't have to control it, if you just want to make the energy get released, you can make a bomb with it. Maybe not a very nice thing to do, but it's been done. You may be wondering, in the atomic bombs that were actually used, is it uranium? Is it plutonium? Both have been used. In the initial use of fission devices, fission bombs in the war, two bombs were dropped. One was based on uranium-235, the other on plutonium-239. I don't want to go on about that too much more. You got a lot of energy. You let it build up. You have heat. It builds up very quickly. A bomb that's the size of a desk can destroy a city. A lot of energy. It'd be nicer if we could control this and use it for power. Controlled fission is necessary for power because you don't want it to blow up. For one thing, you want to have, as each fission happens, it's probably going to cause one more fission, not several more. For another, you want to have a way to stop it or at least slow it down. Controlled fission for power, I actually talked a fair amount about in our seventh lecture back in March when there was the disaster. So I'm not going to redo a lot of that material. You might want to look back at the second half of the lecture, number 7, and see I gave a lot of notes and I showed some diagrams for nuclear power. Fissioning material, uranium or plutonium, or in reality, both together in the same sample, heat water. The water gets hot. The fissioning material gets hot. Hot water, or steam, one or the other, depends on what you want to do, can be used to run a generator. And a generator makes electricity. That's what a generator is. So we can use this process, this nuclear fission, to make electricity. And it makes a lot of electricity. A nuclear power plant puts out gigawatts. That's billions of watts of energy constantly and can keep doing it for decades. Several years between refueling different sections, but decades at least for the whole thing. The plants with a problem in Fukushima, Japan, the first one of those has been running for almost 40 years now. The design is over 40 years old. newer ones have more robust designs that could last longer. And that didn't wear out. That was hit by one of the biggest earthquakes ever, and then one of the biggest tsunamis ever after it. And that's what broke it, not getting old in 40 years. Nuclear power plants also do not create any global warming gases. Carbon dioxide, which we get from coal and diesel power plants, does not come from nuclear power plants. There's no acid rain, which you get from coal in particular, but burning fossil fuels. So we've got good things for the environment about nuclear power. Good things for people, because it makes a lot of power. Good things for the environment in the sense that it does not put carbon dioxide into the air, which creates acid rain and global warming. Also got some bad things. It does create nuclear waste. Radioactive waste is very hard to deal with, and some of it lasts for tens of years, and some of it for billions of years. And you have to put it somewhere safe. Besides the radioactive waste that you know you will get, there's potential for huge accidents. Fukushima. Nuclear accidents, because it's bigger power, can be bigger accidents. So on the one hand, no global warming gases, no acid rain. On the other hand, radioactive waste guaranteed. When there is an accident, it can be a very, very big accident. Chernobyl, decades ago, still no one's allowed to go near there. So a balance, things to decide. Is there another choice? Well, there's another process, the last big topic that we'll cover for the course, nuclear fusion. Not fission, but fusion. Fuse, in English, the verb, is to put things together. You may remember I said earlier that iron is the most stable isotope. And if iron is the most stable, what about the lighter things? In fact, I showed you the graph with binding energy per nucleon. And I showed you that there is a big difference in binding energy per nucleon between iron and uranium. There was also an even bigger difference per nucleon between hydrogen and iron. Hydrogen isotopes had less binding energy. If we look at that graph and we say iron is the most stable, so I'm looking at the same graph again, I want to point to it again. The most stable is this region with iron. I can get a lot of energy per nucleon from uranium. And in fact, per nucleon means there are lots of nucleons there, so it's many times that energy difference when I start fissioning uranium. But if I can start taking things from this part of the graph and getting that amount of energy, that's even more. So even more energy available than fission. Basically, taking small nuclei and pushing them together to make medium-sized nuclei. Not very big ones, not uranium, but medium-sized ones. In fact, we aren't going to go all the way to iron when we do it. I should point out, this is how stars work. Stars, huge amounts of material, stars are much bigger than planets, pushing together. When it's pushed together, the hydrogen, light elements in there, get crushed so much that they fuse into larger nuclei. This stellar theory was worked out in the 1930s. In the 1930s, people had a fairly good theory about roughly how a star works. They're still refining these theories. But the basic ideas, using Einstein's idea about mass and energy and new understanding of nuclear processes, including fusion, in the late 1930s, people understood that this is probably what's happening in stars. Experiments that actually verify that that's what happens in a star are hard to do. You can't just look at a star and say, okay, I see. Must be fusion. In fact, we don't even see the part where the fusion is. If this is the star, right, it's only in the very center, the core, where the fusion occurs. How would you see that? Well, it took until the late 1960s to have experiments that started to see it, and the 1980s until experiments really confirmed that inside the sun, the closest star, nuclear fusion is occurring. And we saw this by looking at those particles called neutrinos that Brad was asking about before. The experimental verification in the 1960s through 1980s resulted in Nobel Prizes in 2002. It takes a while to get a Nobel Prize in physics. In fact, a couple of the people who got the Nobel Prize that year, I have had the pleasure of meeting because I worked with experiments on, worked on experiments with one of them and went to a graduate school where the other one, Ray Davis, was a professor still in the early 1990s. So that experimental verification, part of the Nobel Prizes for that went to Dr. Koshiba from Japan, who worked on experiments in the 80s doing that, experiments in the 90s, where I had the pleasure of meeting him and working with him, and Ray Davis, who was at UPenn when I got my PhD there. So that's my own little connection to that corner of history. Stars work by nuclear fusion. A star does this, as I said, by having large amounts of material that gravity pulls together. Lots of hydrogen in a star. When gravity pulls this together, at the center of the star, you have very, very, very high pressure and very high temperature. You need high pressure and high temperature if you really want fusion to continue. You at least need one of them to even start it. Because of this, if you wanted to build a fusion bomb, there's no such thing as a small fusion bomb. You need high pressure and high temperature, or super high temperature. The bombs that are made since the 1950s that employ nuclear fusion, so-called H-bombs, many people call them, are much more devastating, much larger amounts of energy than bombs based on fission. Fortunately, none have ever been used in battle in the world yet. And even more fortunately, most are being dismantled. If we wanted to not make a bomb, but make a power source, something that would be good for people, we'd have to contain this. Some of the problems are the same problems we have with fission. There are some advantages over fission. More energy per nucleon. When fission happens, we get many, many products, and many of them are radioactive. So we get lots of radioactive waste. When fusion happens, if we take small isotopes and put them into bigger ones, we generally don't get as many radioactive waste products. We do get a radiation issue with neutrons again. Neutrons happen a lot when we have fusion. And those neutrons can irradiate things like concrete walls and make them radioactive. So there's still some radiation, but not as much as with fission. The real problem, though, with controlling fusion is that the temperatures you need, if you had the pressure of the center of the sun, you'd still need the temperature of the center of the sun. that would melt steel, boil steel, in fact. If we don't have the pressure you can reach at the center of the sun, we need even higher temperatures. And the temperatures that would be useful would melt anything. Any material that we know of would be vaporized, in fact. So you can't just build a big kettle and put your fusion in there. It will melt it. That's a difficult problem. Control is therefore very difficult. So basically, there are a few different ways that people have for trying to create fusion. One of them is to take these small nuclei and use magnetic fields to contain them. If you think back about what we studied when I talked about electricity and magnetism, moving charges are affected by magnetic fields. We can design magnetic fields to keep the nuclei close together. That's called magnetic confinement. This is a very rich field for people who do fusion research in terms of getting good results in the laboratory. The other very different way of doing this is called inertial confinement. And with inertial confinement, what happens is they do something, and I'll tell you what in a minute, to make a little pellet of this hydrogen stay in one place for just long enough for fusion to start. And it explodes, but the energy can be collected in heat from the surroundings because it exploded away from any material. So now I want to draw an example of what happens with fusion. And I'm going to do it two ways. I'm going to draw a little picture, and I'm going to draw a process, a nuclear process. So the first process I'm going to draw has an isotope of hydrogen that we call deuterium, which has, like any hydrogen, one proton. And it's got one neutron for a total of two nucleons. And if I take another deuterium, this is not that realistic, but in theory, this could work. If I can push them together, I'll get two protons and a total of four nucleons. And when I look up two in the periodic table, I see that it's helium. The cartoon for this, each of those deuteriums, I can think of as a proton and a neutron stuck together. And the simple process of adding them gives me a helium nucleus. This looks simple on paper. All you have to do is push these things together, and you get that. And that is not radioactive, is not dangerous, it's just helium. It floats away. But it happens at a temperature that's so hot, anything would boil. So one of the tricks, inertial confinement, if you take a little glass bead full of deuterium, and you shoot lasers at it, from all sides, the glass, if there's enough energy in the lasers, will explode. When it explodes, the outside goes away, but the inside pushes the deuterium together with a lot of energy and a lot of pressure. That can create fusion. This type of device also has been a lot of information for technology. Either way, the control is really difficult. And the bottom line on fusion research is that experts have often told us it will be economically viable. That means it'll be a good source of energy in 20 or 30 years. In 20 or 30 years, we could have nuclear fusion devices that will create energy for us. The difficulty is that they've been telling us that for about 50 years. Think about it. 50 years ago, they thought it was 20 or 30 years. We still think it's 20 or 30 years. Honestly, I tend to believe that it will happen someday, but I don't know when. Philip is asking why I think people don't embrace the idea of nuclear power. In fact, 30 years ago, when I was younger, I did not embrace the idea myself because I thought we don't know enough about nuclear power in 1980 or so when I was a young man. We don't know enough to be sure of what will happen. And this was before Three Mile Island and Chernobyl and, of course, well before Fukushima. Since then, I've grown to think that maybe we do understand it more, but honestly, there are a lot of risks. And there is a big social issue. Besides the environmental issue, there's a big social issue about whether we want to depend on huge plants that do everything for the world. So the social issues and the environmental issues are both big things that everyone needs to have a voice on. The risks are large, but the gain is also large. Personally, I also think that society has some issues about trust and science, and some of them perhaps rightly so. I have a few more words to say to end, but before that, I think I want to show a 6-minute video about nuclear power. And if we could cut to the video, and I'll come back after that and give you a few closing words.
What some scientists have their research sights set on the Earth's ultimate energy source, the sun. But they don't plan to harness its power. They want to imitate it. The diameter of the sun is about 100 times that of the Earth. It's a giant ball of pure energy. The sun produces enough energy every second to power our planet for a million years. The sun's energy is generated by nuclear fusion. But we don't need to travel 180 million kilometers to harness fusion power. It can be generated here on Earth.
Fusion is important because it's something that's going to give us a really, really long-term sustainable energy source.
The scientists at the Joint European Torus Nuclear Fusion Research Facility near Oxford are investigating fusion for its potential to provide an unlimited supply of cheap, clean energy.
We are taking the power source of the sun, which is something very ambitious and I think something very worthwhile attempting to do.
In 1945, the world discovered the power of splitting the atom. Today, all nuclear power plants split atoms in nuclear fission reactors. The main drawbacks are a lack of good options for the disposal of spent fuel and the danger of an accident that releases radioactive material into the air or groundwater. But a fusion power plant would produce no deadly radioactive waste. It can't melt down and uses a clean and abundant source of fuel. Inside the Torus experiment, atoms aren't split apart. They're fused together. It's a process that uses no radioactive plutonium or uranium. The fuel is hydrogen. Hydrogen atoms are heated to 150 million degrees centigrade, 10 times hotter than the sun's core. At this extreme temperature, the atoms turn into a plasma. The plasma atoms collide and fuse. Energy is released when the positively charged plasma ions overcome their natural repulsive forces. It's a million times more efficient than today's nuclear power stations, and a trillion times more efficient than fossil fuel. This clean energy confines the high-temperature plasma with magnetic fields. The technology is inherently safe, but the experimental machine is expensive. So more than 160 safety checks take place before the countdown to ensure there will be no damage to the machine.
Everything we do, we need to be totally sure we've got everything right. We can't afford any mistakes, and it can be a little bit tense at times.
The machine is housed behind 2 meters of concrete and steel.
To the pulse, please.
The experiment. The glowing light is plasma, superheated gas, which can reach 200 million degrees. The reaction produces energy like any star in the solar system. Nuclear fusion here on Earth.
We did good.
That was excellent. That worked exactly as we wanted it.
It's perfect.
I'm happy. I think the scientific coordinators are very happy. You can see lots of smiles with that, so which is good.
Nowhere in the world have scientists come closer to creating the ultimate energy source. And the fuel for fusion is virtually unlimited.
One bath full of water would provide enough energy through fusion to supply one person with all their energy needs, so their transport, their heating, their food, their industrial needs, for 30 years.
Because fusion is fueled by hydrogen, there are few security risks. But research is still at the experimental stage. Scientists estimate it will be another 30 years before there will be a commercial fusion power plant.
This is a very long-term strategy. This isn't something that's suddenly going to produce a result tomorrow and solve all our problems. So we will get that. I don't think we have any choice.
Maybe the visionary scientists and entrepreneurs who are developing renewable, clean energy solutions will be able to offer us viable choices. The planet's increasing population and expanding energy demands may well depend on them.
So, I think actually that video may have made things sound even more enticing. You know, it sounds great. It's the perfect thing. And my personal feeling, honestly, nuclear fusion in that 30 years or 30 plus another 50 is probably the way to go. But we need to think about all of the risks and all of the benefits. Little sidebar notes. 10 times the temperature of the core of the sun. Well, we can't get the pressures that the core of the sun has. So there's still these two totally different ways of looking for fusion. Why are we looking for something that we're sure it's going to take 20, 30 years, and some of us are pessimistic and think longer than that? Well, oil, coal, fossil fuels, we've been hearing for quite some time, they will run out in decades. Maybe 100 years, I don't know. Could be 200 years, but they will run out. There is not an infinite supply. Uranium, so much more energy. When could that run out? Frankly, the uranium deposits that we know about in the Earth will run out in 100 years or so. not sure exactly when. Could be 50 years, could be 200 years. But it will run out. Water will run out if you use it forever. But the amounts are minuscule compared to what we have. It's important that we consider many sources. And I think you should think more broadly even, solar energy. But you know what? Solar energy is not environmentally free. A lot of the processes that we use to make solar panels, very environmentally dirty. So there are costs environmentally in many ways. One of the things that I'm really hoping we get to through this course, not today, not when you take the final, but when you sit back and look at it, is the ability to consider these, all these kinds of issues. Energy is a big one. Global warming is another. Consider them scientifically. And a nice scientific question that Cassie just brought up is, how can that camera that's monitoring the fusion reaction, how can that withstand so much heat? Because I said that if you tried to put this in something, it will boil steel. How come the camera's there? That kind of magnetic confinement gives a large distance between the actual zone where things are going on and where any real material is. The inside of that chamber that's being monitored is a vacuum. It's been pumped out, very little material in it. The high temperatures deep within that, far from the walls. And it's a very, very small amount of material that's actually running around in that machine. It goes around like an accelerator. And when it does that, it stays at a high temperature, but the monitoring equipment is far away and protected. Again, I hope you can analyze these, and I hope, Cassie, you like that answer to your question. Finally, I'd like to close with a little picture. The daughter of my department chair and my nephew are still little kids, and they're counting on you to go out and find the science and understand. Thank you.